Hello and welcome to the show. Welcome to Love Talk. Today we're going to be talking about flirting. Now, there's two sides to flirting. If you have a flirtatious nature, but you are in a relationship, as I am with my darling wife, it could be a bit of a problem if you tend to have this flirtatious nature with someone else other than your partner, right?
They call it a wandering eye.
Wandering eye? Like, sometimes you know, more than wandering eye.
Indeed, big problem. But flirting can also be a good skill. Okay, I think it can help in a relationship if you are flirting with the person you are with or to attract the other person.
Yeah.
Or like one of our guests said before we started, it's a good way to see your boundaries, you know, find your boundaries. So it's not always a negative thing.
Absolutely not. And of course, if you're single, if you like someone, you know, perhaps it's a comfortable way of you showing that person that you're interested in them, right? And we're going to be talking about this today. In fact, we have, I wouldn't say a panel, but we have three people here with three very different views and perhaps approaches on flirting. I would say we have a hopeless flirt. I hope she doesn't mind me saying that. We have a in-between and we have a, I don't know, how do we describe it, Charlotte?
Maybe outrageous.
Outrageous.
Oh my God.
Sometimes.
Okay.
Very flirtatious.
We're going to be hearing from you guys in just a moment. And, you know, perhaps you're watching us now and you're that kind of person that you want to give the person you like the right signals.
Mm-hmm.
But then you start to blush. You start to sweat. You start to shake. Actually,
I think... It's not always a bad thing.
Do you think so?
Yeah.
I think when I held your hand for the first time, I was shaking. Was I shaking?
No, I almost died.
I was really...
I was very, very shy.
I hope it's for
terribly
shy. You almost died for the good reasons.
I really liked him. But, you know, to be a bit shy, it's not always a bad thing, I think it's actually attractive depending
on how... But sometimes the person can be almost crippling shy. And hopefully we'll be helping you with some ideas on how to overcome that. In fact, we had a very interesting interview with a flirting coach called Jean Smith. And we want you to see what she had to say. We're going to come back to discuss her points, actually with our panel of flirts. Hopeless, in between, and what did you say, Charlotte?
Outrageous.
Outrageous flirt. So let's watch what Jean Smith had to say. We'll be right back.
And I'm now joined by Jean Smith, cultural and social anthropologist.
Hello.
Hello, Jean.
Hi.
I was about to say hi, Jean, and then do you get that a lot, the hi, Jean
when
thing?
I was about 12, I did.
Oh, okay. I'm a bit immature. But so what is it exactly that you do? It's a very interesting job, in fact.
Yeah, well, I basically research flirting behavior, and then I use this information to teach people how to flirt. In essence, building their confidence.
And how did you even get into that? It's such a unique kind of niche, isn't it?
Yeah, I've thought of that because it is pretty, well, let's say random.
You've cornered the market, basically.
Yes. But I'm actually, since I'm a cultural and social anthropologist, it means that I study people. And so I study what they're doing, and my specific interest is body language and attraction.
Yeah. Do you feel like there's a science to it, like a real science?
Well, what I like to do is bring my anthropology into this, the flirting, because this is an area that people feel so vulnerable, and there's so much subjective advice out there, and, you know, what should I do, and is it okay for a woman to approach a man, and I just feel like people need some quality researched advice. And so I like to bring in the anthropology by using some of the methods that we use. So one is sample size. So people will say, oh, I've tried everything and there's no one out there. I'd be like, okay, what have you tried? Well, you know, one thing. And then how many dates have you been on? Well, two. So again, in anthropology, you need a big enough sample size before you can make any sort of, well, until you know something's real or not. So once you go out with 100 people, for example, and you don't match with any of them, then you can start maybe getting a little frustrated.
Does that happen with some people? Or most people, they see within 100 people, they can find somebody that they click with?
I'm pretty sure within 100 people you'd find somebody, But this leads us to the second part, and that's just about being more objective. So in anthropology, we try and be objective. And this means that we're actually stepping out of the situation and observing. Mm-hmm. So again, when it comes to flirting, everyone is so me-oriented and they get nervous or they just think about themselves and they feel mm-hmm. self-conscious. But if you can be a participant observer, and this is what we call it in anthropology, so you're participating, but you're not so in it that your heart is totally on show and you're full of worry, you're actually still observing.
So what would be your top tips for flirting? Yeah. For the average person?
Well, one is not to have any expectations mm-hmm. about the encounter. In fact, it's not even, I'm going to go flirt now. It's just you're having a nice rapport and you're realizing, ooh, there's something here. There's some chemistry. So the way that you would take it from just like a friendly conversation into flirting is by using one of the 6 signs of attraction that I found in my research. And so just like a couple especially powerful ones would be eye contact. So you'd use your eyes differently.
Eyes? How do you use your eyes?
I think you know, yes.
I think my eyes are about to pop out of their sockets and I might scare someone.
No. But yeah, it's longer. You look longer. It's more intense. Things like this. But another way to get from friendly to flirting and to be able to tell if someone is just being friendly or flirting is touch.
Touch. It's not groping.
No, not groping.
Light touch. Like a little touch.
Well, not only little, but also where you touch is important. So, for example, this is considered, the shoulder is considered a safe zone. And then the further you go down the arm towards the hand, it becomes more intimate. So if you are, you know, in a nice conversation with someone, you could just be like, oh, you're so funny. You know, just give a little tap of the hand.
Just little things like that. Yeah, they get it going, don't they?
Yeah.
And you do a flirting tour, in fact. So you've integrated this into like physically going out and flirting.
Yeah.
How does that work?
Yeah. Well, what I realized is that people's minds stop them from doing so many things. And so in this physical flirting tour, it's a practical tour. When I say physical flirting tour, sounds a bit dodgy, but so this practical tour where we actually go out on the street and I assign people tasks. So we go to everyday locations, galleries, supermarkets, on the street, and then people approach people and start conversations. And then they realize, gosh, this is actually really easy. Mm-hmm. And then the next time their mind is like, don't talk to them, don't do that, they're going to laugh at you. They'll realize, oh, actually, I did that on Jean's tour, and actually, no, that doesn't happen.
So flirting's great if you're single and, you know, you're looking for love or whatever you're looking for, but there are circumstances where flirting can be inappropriate. What do you think those are?
Well, I think flirting in a relationship is still amazing, and the way to keep that spark alive is to basically act like you were when you were dating. Uh-huh. It's not taking your partner for granted. But it's also in that certain couple, understanding what your mutual rules are for flirting. Mm-hmm. I mean,
outside of the relationship.
Yeah. Like yesterday I went to the library and I came back and I said to my husband, I think the guy next to me was flirting with me. He's like, well, I'm not surprised, sweetheart. It should, I'm sure it happens all the time. Or, you know, vice versa. He'll tell me his demographic is like 60-year-old women love him. And so he'll come back with flirting stories. And I'm like, I'm so proud of you. That was great. You know? But on the other hand, in some couples, that might not be good. So it's whatever the two people understand is okay.
It's very different for every single person. There's no set rule. So any last tips for anyone who's not confident enough to flirt?
Yeah, I think just don't take it so seriously. Mm. So as I said, don't have expectations. Don't take it so seriously. And it's just for fun. And flirting is a skill. The more you do it, the better you'll get at it.
Well, thank you so much, Jean. You've been very, very useful today. And everyone's going to like be a little bit better at flirting in London now. And in the country and in the world.
Good.
Thanks to you. So in a nutshell, Jean Smith has explained everything about flirting.
I just want to say that although Jean Smith said that flirting is a skill and the more you do it, the better you get at it. Be careful. It's mm-hmm. not a green card for you to go and flirt with everyone you see around you. Okay?
Yeah.
Please. Right? Now, Disha, you are the person who finds it more difficult to flirt among the three of you. What did you take from that?
Well, I'm not a romantic person.
Okay.
And so my flirting would be, I use humour when I'm talking to someone I like.
Okay.
But I'm not comfortable with, like, I don't hug my friends or anything. So I wouldn't ever be like, I wouldn't want to, like, that's fine.
Like touching.
I wouldn't touch, no.
So if you want to let someone know that you like them, you just
punch them. Yeah, punch them. Or tell a joke or something. That's me. But It doesn't work, obviously, because I'm single. Okay. Been single for years, but...
Even though most women say that if a guy gets them to laugh, that's a good thing. They
like sense of humor, actually.
Or if you make someone laugh like a guy, then they'll think, oh, she's a good friend. So it doesn't... Because I think with flirting, sometimes women that can flirt, they're the ones that get the guys because the guys know that they're interested in them. So I don't think... I've not mastered how skills. To do it properly.
Do you think that... perhaps, like she said, when you try to flirt, it's like you flip a switch and you think I'm flirting, then you get nervous.
I don't think I'm confident enough to naturally be a flirty person.
Okay.
I think I would. If I do really like someone, I just stutter and become a mess. So
I think that the problem, actually, I don't know if you agree with this, is that some people think that flirting is that specific thing or way of doing it. So they feel inappropriate, they feel that they don't know how to do it, so they get nervous.
Yeah.
So maybe it might be your case.
So maybe I should go to her.
It should just be yourself.
Be myself. But
go to her, or maybe don't flip the flirting switch and just think, have a normal conversation, maybe.
Yeah, have a normal conversation. But I don't like chat up lines, so that's one level of flirting that if someone tried a chat up line with me, I'd walk away.
I think few people like chat up lines. I don't think they usually work.
Cheesy.
They're not okay. They are cheesy, aren't they?
Indeed.
But then I'd play on something like that.
Yeah.
I'd just be like, really? You've just said that to me? But then you kind of get talking after that. Do you know what I mean?
It's like
and then it's kind of like a challenge for them because they think, oh, okay, this hasn't worked, but she's talking to me still. Mm-hmm. So now I've got to kind of convince her that I'm okay. Do you know what I mean? It's
really we're going to come back to you guys in just a moment. We're going to go to a break.
Yes.
When we come back, we're going to see, because I imagine they have a lot to say and we want to hear the three parts of the spectrum. But also later on in the program, we have a couple here and they said, I will never get married. Not to each other, but they had made a decision, I will never, ever get married. And today they're here and they're married. So we're going to see what their story is all about. Okay, we're going to go to a break. We'll be right back.
According to a recent survey, what percentage of online daters said that their breakups occurred via email? Was it A, 10%, B, 20%, or C, 48%? We'll tell you after the break. Before the break, we asked you what percentage of online daters said that their breakups occurred by email. And the answer is C, 48%.
Welcome back. Now, I want to go straight to Charlotte and ask you a question. Charlotte, now you've had an interesting experience because of flirting, because of your past relationships. Do you want to tell me a little bit about that?
For example, probably my most recent ex. Basically, you know, just a normal night out in a bar sort of thing. I don't know if it's okay or not, but I would always go up to the bar, talk to people, and I'll talk to you whether you're female, male, it doesn't bother me. Mm-hmm. But obviously some guys, you know, take that as, oh, would you like a drink? And to be honest, I'm not exactly going to say no. I'd be like, okay then, because at the end of the day, I'd rather see him as well buy it rather than just buy one and bring it over, because you know, we know what happens. So I'm like, yeah, okay, I'll get a drink. But obviously my recent ex, he didn't really like that, and he saw this happening and it all kicked off. And then that's when it kind of came out, well, you know, you flirt anyway, and I don't like other things that you've done. And it's like, well, you're only just telling me this now, like, why didn't you say that before and we could address it? But yeah, and then that ended for that reason.
To keep a relationship, would you stop flirting outside of the relationship?
No. I'm going to be completely honest. No.
Yeah.
No. My jobs and things like that, like I've been a waitress, promoting, things like that, I just naturally go up to anyone and talk to them. And I do think I just naturally do flirt in general. And people do say to me, like my friends always say to me, oh, but you're really good at things like that. You know, you go do that. You know, you can talk to people, you flirt with them and sort of thing. I wouldn't, maybe tone it down a little bit. Yeah, because obviously in the past I've realised where sort of a line is, but yeah, it's difficult still, I think,
now,
for me.
I was just thinking, because I read about your story when I knew that you were coming on the show. Would you, in a few years' time, you want to settle down, you meet the right person, Okay. Would you change that?
Probably not.
Tell us
only
why.
Only because my argument is, obviously, if you're attracted to me in the first place through, you know, my personality and flirting and things like that, then why should I change? Because then you're going to not be as attracted to me as you were, and I don't think, you know, this. I just don't think people can change in the first place anyway. Mm-hmm. So why would you want them to? I just don't understand why you want your partner to change. You kind of accept it, don't you? You accept the flaws, and but then you should be, as long as the trust's there and you're happy, you know, thinking, that's okay, I trust her, she's out, you know, flirting or whatever. As long as you trust them, then I don't think it matters.
Although sometimes you think it can be difficult to trust if the person is flirting and you start making things up in your mind.
It's tricky, because I understand what she's saying. If you like me, for, you know, you
for
obviously
you
notice that I am a flirtatious person and so on and so on. But then maybe the person realizes, oh, I really like this person. I don't want to lose her. And I know she's quite flirtatious and attracts other people's attention. So I don't want to lose her. So maybe the person becomes insecure, and I can understand both sides.
I understand that as well. And, you know, I've had that conversation time and time again with my exes.
But how could we make this work then?
I'm guessing it's just finding the right person.
Yeah,
isn't it?
The right person.
Like, I'm quite excited to see what the next people are on to say, because I'm kind of like that. Don't
actually, we have a sketch with a situation similar to yours. A guy is going to get married, but he's very flirtatious with someone at work. So when we come back, we want to see what you guys have to say about that. Okay. You haven't said anything yet, Morris.
Yes.
So we're going to come to you when we come back.
Yes.
Okay. So let's see.
Hello, handsome. What are you up to at the weekend?
Going to the gym to work on these guns.
Your girlfriend's a lucky lady.
Hey, you look really nice today. Oh. That colour really brings out the green in your eyes.
John, charming.
Hey, shall we have lunch later? I want to ask you some questions about my wedding. I've got some ideas I wanted to run past you.
Oh, looking forward to it.
So you see the sketch ended with her sending him a text, let's have lunch, hun. Something like that, XOXO. Morris, what do you think? XOXO?
Yeah, I mean, I personally don't use the XOXO.
XO means what? Kiss, hug, kiss,
kiss
hug?
Kiss, hug, kiss, yeah.
Okay, we're a bit outdated with that.
Yeah, that's okay.
It's been a while.
It's all right. Obviously that was very exaggerated. That was, but there's the underlying thing. Like, I think people do stuff like that, don't they? Mm-hmm. They send the text, and I don't know. Like, in my head, I personally feel that there's this. Everybody knows what they're doing, and everybody likes that. Like, they like to flirt. People like to know that they're doing that flirting thing,
and that someone likes
and
them,
and that somebody likes them back. Exactly. And although our main intention may be that, okay, I'm not going to pursue this to a large level, it may be that. You're just enjoying that moment, and you just really want to like have that, let's say, attention, if you like, and actually enjoy that.
No, but imagine if someone is doing that at work, for example, and then you are just like playing with a person. It's what it is. I mean, it's just like, you know, being flirtatious. Forgive me. But imagine if the other person starts taking that really seriously and. You know, oh my gosh, I'm in love with this person, and what do I do now? You know, you're like pushing it too much, and you think the other person is okay, but it's not. Do you understand what I mean?
I have actually had that exact situation.
How did that pan out?
Not well, awkwardly, shall we say. Originally we were friends, the flirting happened, she then realised that, oh, my husband isn't as good as this person that I'm speaking to, and I'm getting a lot of... happiness that I'm speaking to this person, I don't get that where I'm from, and then she kind of took it to another level and was like, you know, we should meet up and not tell people, what's that? And it ended up not even being friends anymore, because it went too far, and I was in a relationship at the time anyway, so I wouldn't have done that, and it went too far.
But you see, it is possible, isn't it?
It is very easily
dangerous
done.
Ground is
and
dangerous.
I didn't even realise it was happening.
Yeah, and the thing is, when you flirt with someone,
especially a woman, huh? Yeah. Sorry, nothing against you. I'm a woman myself, but
it can mean two different things to two different people, yeah. Right? Because, for example, this year, at the moment you're single, you said that if someone were to flirt with you and he's in a relationship, but maybe you didn't know about it, how would you take that? Would you think this person's interested in me? This could work?
Yeah, you would kind of think that, but then I think as soon as I find out they're in a relationship, I'd be like, oh, maybe this is just their personality. Because you get people that are, I know a couple of guys that are flirty, but they are happily married and they would never cheat on their wife, and that's just them. If it was like the guy in that clip, then yeah, I'd walk out there. That's like flirting.
Now, but you know, sometimes it can be difficult to separate emotions from something you're feeling from the right thing. It can be quite hard, don't you think? Because you said if he's in a happy relationship, then I'll pull back. But what if you couldn't pull back?
Well, I have this. I don't know. It's never happened to me. But if I've ever liked someone and found out they're in a relationship, then straight away they don't become fanciable anymore. It's just.
I think it has a lot to do with principles. Comfortable, you know.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. I don't know. I could meet someone and he could be married, but. Wouldn't probably happen.
I think that comes with experience, though, don't you think? Because my parents, they were both happily married, quite young, so like 18, 19, but then they had an affair together, and now they've been married for 30 years.
Oh, really?
So, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I've always said to them, how did you know that you could trust each other? And they're just like, you just know. You just, which is really strange.
Comes
down
to the person, I suppose.
Although from what you guys are saying, I think flirting can be a very dangerous thing sometimes. Mm-hmm. But
I don't want to play with that.
I want you guys to hear what people actually think on the streets about flirting. What's okay, what's not okay. We went to the streets of London. This is what people actually think about flirting.
Do you mind your partner flirting?
I don't mind him flirting to a certain extent, as long as it's not too far. As long as it doesn't touch, then that's fine. But I find flirting a bit cheesy, really. It's a bit cringy.
I think I won't, because we are humans, so sometimes we do these things like unconscious. I probably do it sometimes without even realizing, so I guess everything goes sometimes. If it's not too far away, I mean, not getting old, can I have your phone? That's something different. But yeah, I think I won. I don't know.
Do you know what happened to me once? I mean, many times. I don't know. People sometimes say this about me, that I'm very,
airheaded.
Away with
things. I don't like that word.
Away with things.
But you know, you don't notice things around you that much. And then sometimes I go to a shop or something, and I grew up like they say, hello, good morning. I grew up in the countryside. Everyone knows everyone. So you're like, hello, good morning. And sometimes the guy thinks I was hitting on him because I was so nice and saying, and the guy, oh, can I have your number? And I said, no. Then I realized, oh, I just said hello and good morning.
What just happened? Yeah.
So, you know, I'm like, oh, gosh.
So what do you think about what that girl said, that, you know, as long as there's no touching, then it's fine?
That's really interesting, because that's exactly... she was saying earlier about how the simplest touch sometimes can give that impression of flirting, and depending on where you touch someone. And she's obviously, the girl on that clip was saying that as long as they don't touch, then that's fine. So they're happy for them to flirt, they trust them to use the words and have the body language, but actually touching is a different thing, and that's a step up. And that's obviously, I think that's a general etiquette that I think a lot of people probably would feel.
Okay. Guys, I think we could do a whole show with you guys here. Unfortunately, we've run out of time. But I want to say something. We're going to be interviewing the couple that we told you that they said we will never get married. But I want to give you my personal opinion about flirting at the end of the show, right? My personal opinion. We've been married for 13 years. So we've made things work. We've had our moments, right? Great moments.
We do flirt a lot with each other.
Yes. I tried to get a little bit better at it. I don't think I was great in
you
the beginning.
You were always wonderful.
But whatever I did, it worked, right?
Of course, it still does.
So we're going to come back after the break, and we're going to see what this couple, this amazing couple, have to say about the story. And we'll tell you at the end what our views on flirting is. It's an important skill, but how to use it. We'll be right back. Welcome back. I'm sure you want to know the story of two people that never wanted to get married and they are now married. Something must have happened.
Yeah, definitely.
Something must have changed. So we want to, I'm sure you at home want to get to know them. So we have them here in the studio. How are you guys?
Hello, hello, James.
Hi. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Fairly newlyweds, right?
Yes.
Yes.
6 months?
Just over 6 months, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's
still on honeymoon.
Yes.
Yes.
It's a pleasure to have you guys here. And by the way, Sam, I was asking you before we started if you still flirt. You said no. And I explained to you, you need to flirt still with your wife.
Just like a novice, I said exactly. No without really thinking too much about it.
Keep it fresh.
But I do flirt. I mean, it's quite an interesting topic we're having. Personally, I am quite a complimenting person. But I've noticed that what I have to do is draw the line, mm-hmm. especially when it comes to giving compliments to, you know, the opposite mm-hmm. sex. But I think it's down to the intention.
Yeah.
You know, the intention behind a person's, you know, flirtation.
Your whatever. Intention may be good, but you know.
As it can be interpreted in the wrong way as well, so.
Now, what we want to know is, probably we can probably start with you, Sam. Why is it that you said, I'll never get married?
Good question. It was a mixture of many things. I think it was my upbringing as well. I had quite a family environment that wasn't, how can I put it, the example wasn't there. Mm-hmm. You know, I didn't really see, you know, I was born into a wedlock. So I didn't really see my mom and my dad together, you know.
Okay.
So to me, that painted a wrong image of how relationships should be from a very young age. I also lost my mom at a very young age as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that had a big part to play with it.
Mm-hmm.
When I got into my teens, I started, of course, in your adolescent age, you want to impress. So it was as though everything that I did, you know, evolved around women. The way I dressed, you know, the music that I listened to, the way I was talking, the walking in the street, the swag that I would have, everything just revolved around trying to impress women. Then I got into my first relationship. That didn't go too well. You know, I was very emotional.
Why was that?
I was very needy because I think with the issues that I had growing up,
mm-hmm.
I was looking for something to kind of like, you know, feed that need.
Mm-hmm.
Just to
feel loved and
to
important.
Feel loved, to feel wanted, to belong. But, you know, I was also naive. I was young as well, so
although,
I made the wrong choices.
Although usually would you say it's more women that are needy, Lena?
No.
Really?
No, men are also, men can also be very needed.
Yeah.
So, needy, because sometimes you see these well, I remember one in particular in my college, when I was around that age, he was very, you know, flirtatious all the time. He was hanging around with different girls, but and it turns out that when we happened to find out later on that he had a lot of issues at home.
Okay.
You know, the father wasn't around, and he was very rebellious. A lot of issues, and I thought that explained it.
So that relationship broke up because you were very needy.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I mean, she was on she was on au pair. She's from Switzerland, so she had to go back in the end.
Okay.
So that separation, I mean, we tried a long-distance relationship. That didn't work.
Okay.
It didn't go down too well. And then when I got into uni, then started, you know, living a life as you do in uni, going out a lot, drinking a lot, and talking about the flirtation. To me, I wasn't a flirtatious person. You know, I was very introvert. But after I've had a few drinks, then that was my, you know, Dutch courage for me too. It's very interesting what Murray said. You know, to me, it was, I will flirt just to kind of like boost my confidence and just to find my way around, you know, the social circle and trying to
see how far you could go.
Exactly, exactly. But then years down the line, I went too far, you know, a few one-night stands and bad relationship, bad choices. Even to the point where I even contracted STD as well, you know, that's how serious it got. And that just built up so much anger inside of me. Because within me, I had always had the aspiration for me to kind of like not to do what my parents, you
did.
Know, not exactly. You know, I always had a picture in my mind to have a happy family, to be, to meet the right person, to have my children with the same person, and also build happy family. But as the time was going on, I wasn't, you know, it wasn't happening.
But did you
Go ahead. Yeah.
But did you happen to understand at the time why things weren't happening?
No, I was none the wise. Maybe
you never actually dealt with those issues.
This is the problem. It's as though instead of dealing with the issues, I was just looking for things to sugarcoat it, just to just to fill the void, and it wasn't happening.
Because actually, along the way, you were making a lot of mistakes, a lot of bad choices, right? So you felt frustrated. Now, was this? At what point did you say, "I'm not ever going to get married"?
I think it was one of the lowest points of my life when I even actually became suicidal. You know, I've had a thought in my mind because life just threw so many garbage at me that I just had enough. Right. And many of the reasons why I came to that conclusion of even wanting to kill myself was because of the choices, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, my relationships were so bad that some of them were violent, some of them were abusive, and, you know, it was just too much.
It left a lot of marks on you, I imagine.
Too many scars.
Mm. So you got to a point you said, enough is enough.
Enough is enough.
I don't want this anymore.
I don't want it anymore.
Right. Mm. Now, what about you, Mary? Why did you say, I'm never going to get married?
Well, similar to my husband, now husband, when I was younger, I didn't really see kind of like the happy family kind of unit at home. In fact, I saw my mum like in a lot of abusive relationships. So I kind of like built up not a hatred, but kind of like a bit of an anger towards men, seeing the way they treated my mum. And also I had a lot of complexes inside me, right? Mm-hmm. Going through school, I was bullied and that kind of like sent me on a downturn. I wouldn't even think about men, to be honest. I was just too busy worrying about myself, growing up, issues that I was going through, bullying and whatnot. And then I started seeing my friends, obviously when I got into my teens, having relationships and stuff, I started feeling a bit left out. So I kind of like had my first relationship at 18, but I had a lot of baggage inside of me. So the first person that was interested to me, I threw myself like at him, not at him, but like I threw myself into the
You're
relationship.
Just surrendered.
Like, yeah, exactly. You know? And like I was 18, he was like 39 or something, which was
that's huge.
So he kind of like, looking back now, I can see like he played on kind of like emotions of people would tell me like, he's quite old, but I was like, no, just try to fit in, have a boyfriend. And then,
how long did that last for, that relationship?
Like 4 years.
Really?
Wow. Yeah, and I found out along the way that he actually had a wife back home in Ghana. Oh. He had kids, and me being quite insecure and stuff, I was still accepting just to be like,
you just wanted some
way.
Love. So.
Yeah, exactly.
So, sorry to cut in on you, but you were quite different from Disha, who was here at the beginning of the show, and she said, if I found out that the person was in a relationship, I would pull out. But by then you were emotionally involved.
Yeah.
Did you find it difficult to break that up because of the emotions?
Very, very difficult to break up because of the emotions. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, I thought, okay, this is the love of my life, as I thought then. But I still didn't believe that I could get married. That was, you know, I was thinking that, you know, I'll just be in the relationship for the sake of being in the relationship. And like you said, I was quite needy. I wanted to be loved. I didn't live with my dad when I was growing up. I saw my mum being really badly treated.
Because it's quite interesting. You're choosing someone who's a lot older. Mm. That kind of shows that you were looking for protection, for, you know, many things, you know, that really
and
shows.
Do you think that because you had all these issues, insecurities and complexes, that maybe you thought that perhaps I'm not good enough to have someone, you know, who will love me, will not have anybody else and so on? Did you feel that?
Yeah, I actually did feel that way, actually, because once that relationship ended, it was almost like I needed the next relationship, but I still had those kind of thoughts that, you know, I wouldn't be able to find someone that would be, you know, faithful to me, but I still just was looking for that love. It's like I was searching for something, but I couldn't find it. So I had another relationship, long relationship that lasted another 4 or 5 years. And then I found that person had a child, and then that broke up, and I went with somebody else who was a bit more of my age group. But that relationship was just really nasty, and I got pregnant. So many things happened. After that, I just thought, you know what, to hell with my love life, I'm going to focus on my career. So that was something, when I finished uni, I kind of like said, okay, I'm just going to focus on my career, get myself on the career ladder. And that was something that I saw movements in, and I felt positive about myself. Mm-hmm. So then I just kind of like kicked my love life to the side.
So that's when you said, I'm not going to get married.
Yeah, I said, I'm not going to get married. I'm not even going to bother with it. Like, all the failed relationships that I had, I said, I'm not even going to bother with it. I kind of, like, put it in the cupboard and just focused on my career.
Right. So the truth is, you never dealt with the problem.
No,
you
were still doing
it. Right?
Or him.
Now, something happened because you guys are married, right? So we want to hear about that after the break. And we want to know what changed you, because something changed. I imagine that now you've dealt with those issues, right?
Yeah.
Because the thing is, a lot of people think, if I get married, if I find someone, maybe I haven't dealt with the issues that I had, but as long as I have someone, that solves my problem. And it doesn't.
It doesn't. It never does.
It's like something crumbling from the inside. Mm-hmm. So we're going to go into a break, and we're going to see what's happening in the world of celebrity gossip. When we come back, you're going to see how Samuel and Mary managed to change the way they think, the way they feel, and today they're happily married. We'll be right back.
On this week's Celebrity Goss, it's fair to say Rihanna's not always had the best taste in men, so we're glad to reveal that she's back with Drake, and they're even talking about living together. After a series of intense dates in Paris last week, the rapper asked Riri to move her things into his LA mansion. The couple first dated back in 2010 when Drake admitted that Riri broke his heart. Better luck second time, Drake! We thought Katy Perry had tamed the womanizer that is John Mayer, so we were gutted to hear that one of Pop's best-looking couples split last week. Sources say he wasn't getting enough attention from Katy, and despite her having a tour planned, he wanted her to drop everything and come to Australia. He wants her to be at home with him, planning for a family and relaxing, but she wasn't ready for all of that. Marriage is definitely no longer on the cards for these two unless someone makes a change. Kourtney and Scott from Keeping Up with the Kardashians are having rows over a picture where Khloe, her younger sister, and Scott are spotted holding hands. Friends say that this photo has been the final straw in a series of rows between them, and that the couple were already sleeping in separate rooms. According to sources, every time they have a fight, Scott runs to her sister for sympathy, and he knows it can drive Kourtney mad. She knows deep down nothing is going wrong, but she can't stand that physical contact, no matter how innocent. And that's all for this week's Celebrity Goss.
Right, I'm sure that by now everyone wants to know how you managed to change the way that you were thinking.
What happened?
Mary, for how many years did you put your love life in the cupboard?
I would say for about 4 years.
4 years?
Yeah, 4 or 5 years.
So what changed? What made you think, actually, I can be happy, I can find someone?
Well, it all started, like I said, I was progressing on my career and everything like that. And then it got to a point where I was like, okay, so I'm getting, you know, getting somewhere.
Mm.
And I started to feel a bit lonely.
Like, I'm surprised.
Because there's only so, I think, like, even though I kind of like put it all to the side, at the back of my mind, you still have that dream as a girl of being married and, you know, walking down that aisle, finding the one. So even though I was, you know, trying to put in the cupboard my love life, I started to feel a bit lonely.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, okay, so where's this all coming from? And then I will speak to my mom and friends and be like, okay, so there's no one that you like, this, that, and the other. And then I started to come into the love therapy seminars as well. And that really helped me to realize that, you know, there is someone out there mm-hmm. for me, and I actually needed to deal with certain issues within myself. So kind of like saw that I needed to change certain things. So I started to become quite selfish, a little bit proud because I was a woman, kind of independent.
Mm-hmm.
And then all the thoughts of me not being happy and stuff, I kind of like dealt with those and kind of got to the root of the problem, that it's not that there wasn't someone out there for me, that I could be happily married, but I just had bad experiences. But it didn't mean my future had to be based on those bad experiences. Mm-hmm. There was a learning curve, so I kind of like knew what to watch out for.
Okay.
And it's interesting you were saying that although you were doing very well in your career, you felt lonely. Mm-hmm. And I was just thinking that usually they say that diamonds are a girl's best friend. But when you're cold at night, they don't make you warm, right?
Yeah. Especially things like Valentine's Day, those moments where, you know, it's all about love and then it's just you by yourself.
You don't even need any diamonds. You just need someone by yourself.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So what about you, Samuel? What changed you? What made you, I mean, did you deal also with the issues you had, the frustrations you had?
I had to deal with it. For me to move on, I had to deal with those issues.
Mm-hmm.
Just like my wife was saying, the decision for me not to ever get married was the wrong decision. But nevertheless, looking back now, the time out that I had actually gave me the means to actually reflect on my choices, on my decisions, and all the bad experiences that I made before. And it was an issue of, you know, my principles and values, you know. Being that I made so many bad choices, I had just kind of like lost, just thrown out all my values and, you know, principles out the window. And I also, I mean, I had a son as well from my past relationship. And so the responsibility of actually having to take care of my son then started making me to think, you know, I started, that helped me to start being more responsible and in putting my efforts in looking after him. That made me to start thinking, you know what, if you are changing your attitude and your ways towards your son, then what about your love life? You know, and like my wife was also saying, I've always had a dream and the aspiration to be happy. And when you have a dream in you, it's inside of you. Sooner or later, it's going to be knocking at you. And there were people that were, you know, approaching me, asking, you know, are you single? Can I take, you know, so on and so forth. So I knew it was as though there was pressure. So it was a case of, okay, deal with this now and actually, you know, change your ways and find the right person. Or
now I want to ask you something. We were talking about flirting earlier. How smooth were you when you approached her? Because I know you weren't that smooth, Samuel. I know the story a little bit. How was that first approach?
Very direct.
Yeah.
Brass. Very direct. Tell us about it.
Very to the point. Like,
how was it? Tell us, Mary.
He just approached me and was like, hi, is your name Mary? And I was like, yeah, that's my name. And it was, like, it was actually saying, oh, are you coming to one of the love therapy sessions? I was like, yeah, I'm going to be going. And I was like, okay, I'll speak to you then.
So you actually met there, right?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I was just thought, okay. I didn't really think it was a chat up line or anything. I was, I wasn't sure. I was a bit in between.
So you...
I was still scarred from my past experiences. So I just wanted to make sure. If she was interested, then yeah, we'll take you further. If not, then...
You're like interviewing her, like a, yes, a job interview.
So although you were more experienced, shall we say, your flirting skills were nil.
Nil.
Now, what attracted you to Samuel? Was it his luscious hair?
If only. Golden locks. No, what really attracted me to him was like his kind of his character. He was open. He seemed quite sincere. He was really honest. That's what really kind of, you know, really struck me, because thinking about my past relationships where there's lots of dishonesty, he was quite open, talking about, he told me like up front about his son, about kind of like his goals, the problems that he's had before in the past, where he wanted to go. I saw that we kind of like had commonality as well, you know, because we had the same type of interests, values, morals. So these types of things actually stood out for me. I thought, okay, let me take stock of this.
And I just want to say, Lenny, you know, there's a lot of people who say, I'm interested in someone, but he's got a son or she's got a son. So he's, you know, he's not a potential, you know, I don't know, a potential future partner. But sometimes that person has so much to offer.
Sometimes they do have a lot to offer. This is my personal opinion. Imagine I don't have any children, and then I get together with this person. It's going to teach me, you know, different things that I never learned before. I mean, and this person has so much to offer me. They've been through so much to raise a child on their own. I mean, you know, it's kind of, wow.
And and please, if you're watching us, we're not being patronizing. We're just being sincere.
Definitely.
Because we know a lot of people who say, look, this person, not this person because he has a son, not that person because he has a daughter. No, I want someone, you know, with a lot of hair, right? A lot of hair, no kids, this high, this a lot of muscles. And the thing is, sometimes you need to see the person beyond that, because even if the person has all those things will not be there forever. The hair, trust me, I can tell you myself, it doesn't last forever. So, you know, saw the qualities he had, the qualities she had. So you guys have been married for 6 months. How have those 6 months been?
It's been wonderful. It's been wonderful, you know, and it's not how can I say
cliche.
It's not a cliche, or you know, we're not trying to sugarcoat it. It's
still
because we've
getting to know each other.
We're still getting to know each other, but I believe the 4 years that we've known each other has given us time to know the traits, the characteristics, like my wife was saying, to find in each other the suitability of you know, this relationship that we have. Because I know I'm a little bit too straight to the point, as I was when I first met her. But I just wanted to make sure that she was the right person. Uh-huh. But the time
of
that
course,
we've had
you didn't
so
get
far,
hurt
exactly.
Again.
You see, so I was a little bit cautious, but yeah. You know, mm-hmm.
I would say from a woman perspective, like I think I feel really secure now. I feel like all the loneliness thoughts I had are all gone. And it's just nice to have someone there that you can depend on, they can depend on you, you can plan your future together, and we have fun, and we're still getting to know each other, so there's little elements where you're treading on eggshells
there's
and
adjustment
stuff.
Sometimes, right?
Adjustment,
you have to adjust.
Yeah, but it's wonderful, it really is.
And I want to ask you something, Mary, what's your advice to that woman or that man who thinks, I never want to be with someone long term. I never want to get married because of things I've been through. Mm-hmm. What do you have to say to people?
What I would
say, who think like this?
Because I was in a similar situation. I would say, first of all, you'd have to identify what the reasons are, like the roots of the problem. Because it's mm-hmm. often that you'll find that, I think everyone at some stage want to be happy in their love life. Mm-hmm. Maybe not to simply get married, but they want to be happy. So it's first of all identifying the reasons why they've come to that conclusion mm-hmm. and actually taking steps then to deal with it mm-hmm. because you'll find that if you don't, it's almost like a rope around your neck going mm-hmm. through life, because there'll always be a situation whereby you will think about your love life. It's inevitable. It's mm-hmm. part of a life. It's part of humanity, right? So I would say, first of all, to kind of like face the situation. Don't throw it in the closet like I did. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, take kind of like steps mm-hmm. to identify the roots and kind of like once you've identified why, you know, give it a try.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Guys, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank
we
you.
Ran
thank
out
you.
Of
very
time.
Inspiring.
And like we promised, as we promised earlier, I want to tell you where we stand on flirting. Let's talk about flirting for singles, right? Mm. If you're single and you like someone, it's important that you know how to flirt, to show the person you like them, because flirting, it's, you know, it's a word that sometimes people think too much about it, and actually it's yeah. just showing someone that you like them.
Yes, and right? And to do that, I think the best way is to be yourself. Mm-hmm. So if you are a little bit shy, if you are a little bit, you know, if you like to make jokes, it depends. Some people like start joking because they're so nervous, so they
I remember
they make no sense when they speak, like me when we were dating. Remember?
I remember when when I was dating Elena, after the first few dates, I asked, so where do you see our relationship going? And she said, well, I'm going forward. If you want to go forward, you come forward with me.
I was a bit like him, maybe. Yeah. I was very, because, you know, I didn't want to be deceived again.
And I said, oh, all right.
And who is this guy? Is he going to waste my time? Or, you know, so, who are you?
So, I mean, I didn't have a lot of flirting skills. Elena had zero.
You do have. I always tell him he has smiley eyes.
Okay, let's leave that for another show. Now, let's talk about flirting when you are in a relationship. You know, when you're in a relationship, you have to weigh what's more important for you. And for me, there's nothing more important than my marriage, than my relationship. It's the foundation of my life. It starts from there. So if I think that it's my relationship is that important, certainly I cannot jeopardize my relationship with anything. So if there is a line, if we have set a line as this is permissible, this is not, then we cannot cross that line.
And today my point is exactly the same as my husband. It's too precious. It took me, for example, it took me a long time to find the right person. It took me a lot of effort, a lot of feeling lonely, because I didn't want to just give myself to just anyone. So I don't want to put that at risk for nothing. So this is just my opinion. I don't like to play with fire, if that makes sense. But it's just
so, you know, put your relationship on a scale, and if it is that important to you, then don't jeopardize it with anything. Okay, if you think that relationship is not going anywhere, it just started and it's not going to last very long, then do things the right way. Take the right steps. But don't jeopardize something that is very important for you, okay? Unfortunately, we ran out of time. We had so much more to say, but we ran out of time. But we'll be back next week. Until then, have a wonderful afternoon.